Now it's on. I want to talk with you tonight about the proposed nation-state law that in some form or another will come before the Knesset sometime, probably this week, probably Wednesday. Have you been following this? Have you heard about this law that is coming before the Knesset? For those that are unfamiliar with the legislation, it was originally drafted by the right wing's member of Knesset, Zev Elkin of the Likud party, which is Netanyahu's party. And it's an attempt to resolve the tension, perceived tension perhaps, between the country's dual Jewish and democratic character, as is enshrined in the Israeli Declaration of Independence. It does that by defining Jewishness as the default nature of the state in any instance, legal or legislative, in which the state's Jewishness and its democratic aspirations might clash. The bill defines the state of Israel's identity as the nation-state of the Jewish people. That not only means that the country's national holidays are Jewish and religious holidays, or that the flag has a Mogen David on it, but it also means that the Jewish law, or that Jewish law, will be the inspiration for all of Israel's legal system, and it enshrines the automatic citizenship granted by the law of return. On its surface, that all seems relatively okay, but when you boil down and you get into the details, and we know the saying that God is in the details, right? There are some very, very problematic and troubling things here that leak really not that far beneath the surface. Crucially, while the bill affirms the personal rights of all of Israel's citizens according to law, it reserves communal rights for Jews only. In other words, individual Arabs are equal in the eyes of the law, but their communal rights are not recognized at all. So tonight I want to talk about the law. I want to talk about its origin and, as I understand it, its implications. Tomorrow morning, if you come for services at 10 a.m., we'll study the draft text of the law. It's just three double-spaced pages in English. And while it's not the final version, we'll discuss our thoughts and our reactions to it. So let me begin with a bit of context. It is natural and expected for nations to change and evolve over time. Thank God that they do. And for their founding documents to change and evolve along with them, to reflect that change. The United States, which I know better than I do Canada, so I'll reference that first. I'm getting to know Canada. Was founded by slave owners, and for its first 100 years, enshrined in its documents the right to own slaves, to own other human beings as property. That was not only the law of the land, but it was to a great deal the economic system that the United States was founded upon. And it was infamously canonized in Article 4 of the U.S. Constitution that required, among other things, that if your slave escaped and you found an escaped slave, you were required, obligated by law, to return that person, whether he wasn't a person in the eyes of the law, to its rightful owner as though lost property. And the law that they cited for that in drafting it, if you read some of the commentary on the Constitution, goes all the way back to the Bible and the story of the lost cow or heifer that wanders in a village and whose responsibility is to return it. Human beings were created like cattle. But through time and civil war and a great deal of anguish and one hope, some wisdom, the U.S. evolved. It removed from its otherwise, I think, majestic code of law and constitution the stain of slavery. And while that stain is off the page, it, of course, lingers in the streets of the cities of the United States. It lingers in Ferguson, Missouri, among many. Canada, too, has its own stain on an otherwise mostly praiseworthy history of human rights and social contract. The record of Canada's treatment of the First Nations is better known to you than it is to me, but my reading of the 1998 Statement of Reconciliation makes clear the shame and regret felt by a country that prides itself on peace, order, and good government, a model for other nations to follow around the world. It is hard to square a nation that values the mosaic of cultures and languages and faiths and peoples with its own history of abuse of aboriginals. And so the law was changed to reflect the true nature of this incredible country that I am coming to love every single day. And still, of course, there is the hurt and the pain. It lingers. And so when Israel was founded in 1948, its founders had, I think, a tremendous amount of wisdom and a great deal of foresight to establish in its Declaration of Independence not just a state for the Jewish people, but a nation that would be a model of freedom and democracy for all peoples. For more than 40 years prior to the founding of the State of Israel, beginning with the first Zionist Congress, Herzl and Jabotinsky, and then later joined Ben-Gurion and Golda Meir, and even Rav Kook, labored over just the right balance of Jewish and democratic. They wrote and declared the following: "The State of Israel will be open to the immigration of Jews and for the ingathering of the exiles from all countries of their dispersion, and will promote the development of the country for the benefit of all of its inhabitants, will be based on the precepts of liberty, justice, and peace, as envisioned by the prophets of Israel, will uphold the full social and political equality of all of its citizens, without distinction of race, creed, or sex, will guarantee full freedom of conscience, worship, and education and culture, will safeguard the sanctity and the inviolability of the shrines and holy places of all religions, and will dedicate itself to the principles of the Charter of the United Nations." I am proud of that clause in the Israeli Declaration of Independence. I'm proud of the entire document. We are proud of it. In fact, knowingly or not, we cite it all the time when we are defending Israel to those that would delegitimize or even criticize Israel. Because what do we say? We say that Israel is the only democracy in the Middle East. Right? Israel is the only country in the Middle East that guarantees religious freedom. Israel is the only country in the Middle East that has rights for people LGBT, gay, lesbian, transgender, bisexual. Israel is the only country in the Middle East that guarantees equality amongst genders. Israel is the only country that guarantees freedom of speech and freedom of press and assembly and religion for all of its citizens in the entire Middle East. We cite that chapter and verse time and again, and proudly we do. This is the moral high ground upon which the nation and the people of Israel, and indeed the Jewish people all around the world who love and support Israel, it is the moral high ground upon which we stand. And so why would we change that? Why would we mess with that? If it ain't broke, don't fix it. So what's at play here? That such a law as the nation-state law would even be considered. Why abandon such high ideals? Why abandon such a beautiful text? So this past Rosh Hashanah, I shared with you my grave concern about the growing hatred amongst Jews in Israel and around the globe towards Arabs. My concern and my admonition was grounded in Jewish sources and teachings, but it was built upon a line from the Jedi Master Yoda from Star Wars, if you remember. Which, by the way, doesn't make it any less true. I think it only makes it more universal. Yoda taught, "Fear leads to anger, anger leads to hate, hate leads to suffering." Why is the governing coalition of Israel proposing a change to the basic law and the underlying principles of Israeli democracy? Because of fear, because of anger, because of hate, and because of suffering. Israel fears losing the Jewishness of the Jewish state, as though that were possible. The demographics have been the canary in the mineshaft for decades. In spite of 1 million Russian Olim, Russian immigrants, and hundreds of thousands of Ethiopian Jews, and an Orthodox birth rate that makes the Mormons look at them and say, "Well, look what they're doing." Jewish Israel is shrinking demographically as compared to Israeli Arabs and Palestinians. Israel has many fears, and being a Jewish minority governing an Arab majority, is chief among them. Anger is building within Israel. And really throughout the Jewish people, we feel it here in this community. As the UN and the EU and NGOs around the globe condemn Israel for combating the same Islamic radicalism that has brought the world to what I think is a de facto Third World War, the hypocrisy of this double standard, it boils over, and anger gives way to hate. And the hate is broad and it is deep. It has been building over years of bombings and missiles and kidnappings. And it is a hate that stems from fruitless national sacrifices of land and treasure, a mountain of olive branches rejected time and again by an Arab leadership that holds its own people hostage rather than negotiate for peace. It's a hate rooted in Golda Meir's oft-quoted line and observation that we can forgive the Arabs for killing our children, but we cannot forgive them for forcing us to kill their children. Whole generations of people on both sides have never known peace. They have never known good Arabs or good Israelis, only to fear them, only to fight them, to hate them, because they are the reason for their suffering. And I understand Arab fear and anger and hatred of us. They are suffering, and we are a far more acceptable target for their rage than their own corrupt leadership. What I want to challenge tonight is our fear, our anger, our hatred, our suffering of them. Not because it's not warranted. It is. The terror attacks last week in the synagogue, the cars used as weapons of mass murder, the kidnappings of soldiers and civilians, these didn't happen on some distant battlefield far away. They happened in the streets and the neighborhoods of Israeli towns and villages. I don't deny the emotions on either side. I just think that this law will not make things better. It will make things worse. Not so much for the Arabs, to be honest, because in truth, what the law proposes is really already the standard of practice in Israel, as shameful and as abhorrent as that is. Arabs are treated like second-class citizens in Israel. They really are. Everybody knows it. Many people talk about it. You can read about it in the Jerusalem Post and Haaretz, and certainly in their press. It is a shanda, an embarrassment. But it's not the only one. This law is a shanda. This law is an embarrassment. It is anti-Zionist. Ari Shavit, who, if you don't read him, you should, who writes for Haaretz and, of course, wrote the best-selling book, My Promised Land, that was all the rage, if you would, two summers ago. He wrote this week in Haaretz the following, and I'm quoting him here, it's about two paragraphs. The secret of the National Jewish Movement's success was that it created a sharp contrast between itself and the space or place that it settled in. If there's a desert around us, we're an oasis. If there is despotism about us, we're a democracy. If we're surrounded by backwardness, we're progress. If there's fanaticism and death ritual around us, we're moderation and choice of life. But the leaders of the Knesset insist on blurring the contrast. In the most sensitive period of our history, they are trying to turn us into an inseparable part of a tribal, nationalist, messianic, violent region. The new anti-Zionists have taken over the government and the Knesset and are undermining Israel's foundations and setting Jerusalem on fire and bringing disaster upon us. End quote. You should read Shavit. On some level, I am, and this is odd, I know, to say, on some level, I am glad that this law is up for debate, because it brings out into the open the dark secret of modern Israeli society of these past few years, that there is racism in Israel today, not only Jews against Arabs, but Jews against Jews. Because the other aspect of this proposed law that has gotten the Jewish world so galvanized against it is the provision that all laws in the country must be based in Jewish law. Again, on its surface, that sounds fine. Comically, though, liberal Jews and Orthodox Jews are actually in agreement about hating this part of the law and opposing this provision, though they are in agreement about that for diametrically opposite points of view or reasons. Liberal Jews are horrified at the idea that democracy will take a backseat to halakha. Look, I know that we taught you, or your religious school teachers taught you, that Jewish law is quaint and wonderful and loving and always correct and always wise and versatile system of justice. And at times it is. But at other times, it is terribly arcane. It is incredibly chauvinistic. It is ill-informed, and sometimes it is just downright wrong. It's not that the Torah is flawed per se, but rather the interpretation of Torah that ceased in the year 800 CE when the Talmud, which is really halakha, was canonized, is terribly inadequate for modern life. Thus, much is subject to interpretation, and liberal Jews, we're not going to be the ones that are doing the interpreting. The Orthodox oppose this new law because it still references democratic values. They say, like we say, you can't have both Jewish law and democracy, only they want to throw out the democracy part. There is so much more that can and needs to be said about this law and the danger that it poses to Zionism and to the Zionist dream, let alone to the Zionist reality up to this point of Israel. But let me close briefly with one last observation from Ari Shavit. In the 21st century, there is no Jewish state that isn't democratic. And in the Middle East, there is no democratic state that isn't Jewish. If this law were to pass, neither of those statements would continue to be true. Join me tomorrow morning and we'll talk about it some more. Shabbat Shalom.